the worst Grand Theft Auto.
By the way, we are now live on the air at diamondclub.tv, which is an important thing for me to say before I ask Justin, how was the rest of the bachelor party that I missed out on?
It was very nice. We, man, I'm old, folks. Hey, here's a fun fact. You know, might seem like it's a fun thing to just hang out and get drunk and then party all the time.
Yeah,
but did you like it's work.
Getting old means realizing there's such a thing as enough.
Well, here's the difference. It's almost really just a confidence for me to say, hey, I don't want to do this anymore. You know? And yeah, it's like, there's just that element of like, all right, so you're out and you're having a good time. And it's like, before it's like, oh, okay, well, let's rally and keep it going. And now I'm just like, you want to know what? I'm going to take a nap. I'm just going to go in for a couple hours.
We're on Channel 3 on Alpha Geek Radio. Is that right, Neshcom? I want to say it's right. You'd think I know by now, but you'd be wrong, sucker. Let's do Alpha Geek 3. And God, you hear the shootout downstairs?
What is that?
That's the spin cycle happening. But Alpha Geek Radio is down, so I don't have to worry about making that work. Great. That's the spin cycle on the washer freaking out, and it's
like, are you washing a Buick?
Yeah. Awesome. So let me
big washer. It's Texas, man.
Man, it makes me wonder where Bonnie is, because usually she runs and shuts that down.
Do you have the mangler?
Yes. Here, you know what? I'm actually going to lower this seat. Maybe two notches lower the seat. Let's see if this is too weird.
It turned into a Kohl's coupon.
Oh, there we go. Yeah.
All we need is a Steinmart, you know.
Check. I am setting my level now. Test 1, 2, and I had a cow. Boy, have a cow. When's the last time someone said that? Jeez. Check. All right, I'm good. Let me get you, Murphy.
Check. Hello.
All right. Andrew?
Hi, I'm Andrew, and if my voice starts to suck, let me know, and I'll put in some headphones.
No, you're sounding pretty good, actually. Justin?
Hi, this is me. I'm talking. I'm on the onboard mic.
Hang on. You know what? I'm going to put you on a different audio channel so I can control you separately.
You can't control that, Bri. You should know this by now. It's unstoppable.
I should. You're right. Okay, say again, Justin.
Hi, I'm talking to you. I'm doing the show. Bleep, bop, bloop.
Great. All right, I'm going to close that door and pretend I don't hear that noise. Also, don't pretend like the master control program isn't pulsing enraged in the background. I have no idea why this light is doing that.
It kind of looks cool. I kind of like it.
Maybe it's a trans-dimensional astronaut begging me not to do this Weird Things podcast.
Yes, it's the Indian in the cupboard.
Dude, Native American, please.
All right. And then,
New Delhi.
That's right. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, let's do, I'm gonna set up the second screen here. diamondclub.tv/second screen. Right on. So hey, Andrew, I don't know how much of an agenda you had, but I had an idea for a discussion that I think could take us a good 15, 20 minutes to discuss how it would go through. I don't know.
Well, I got stuff I can push. The thing I'd love to do at the top, unless your thing is really urgent and more important than my thing, Brian.
No, it's never the case.
I got to try the HTC Vive, their virtual reality system.
Okay, let's start with that, and then when we feel a little, there was a black hole of thought experiment that I went through, and I was like, you know who I'd really like to talk to these about with are the gang.
Jason Murphy.
Yeah. Man, I guess, okay, so let's tweet out now to everyone that we're live at diamondclub.tv. Live now for the weird thing. Things podcast with special guest at Captain Murphy. diamondclub.tv/
Chase, what are you captain of, just so I can be clear?
It's just from C-Lab.
Do you remember C-Lab 2021?
Vaguely.
The gang that do Archer, I guess, used to do.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
All right. Okay. Yeah, that's all. Yeah. So basically,
it's a tribute. Dude, yeah. Nobody how much Jason Murphy loved that show was when the guy who voiced Captain Murphy died.
I quit watching.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah. You that's right. They brought in some other.
It was his
football
brother,
coach,
like,
or something.
Skip, the football coach, his high school football coach brother.
Yeah.
Which is a fun, zany idea, but it wasn't Captain Murphy.
Yeah.
You want the mustache on or off? Yeah. Too bad.
Bizarro, bizarro.
And now there's a hip hop artist named Captain Murphy now. And he's an alternate identity to a guy named Flying Lotus, who's reasonably popular and also somehow affiliated with Adult Swim, through which I've yet to discern.
Uh-huh.
And his fans are constantly badgering me and following me. And I'm like, you're going to be real disappointed because I'm kind of the antithesis of this badass hip hop artist. All right.
That's amazing.
But some people are like, hey, you should just give him your name. No, now I'm just holding on to it out of spite.
Yeah. Right? As you watch us do weird things, you can follow along in a second screen at HD. I'm going to pimp the second screen experience for everyone. But Diamond
Club. Second screen for an internet experience?
That's what I'm saying. Internet experience on the internet.
Yeah.
And then a second screen for that.
The internet will experience you in a way that it never has before. Through a second screen.
All right. I think we're ready to start. You ready to go, gentlemen?
Let's rock.
Ready? 5, 4, 3, 2.
Welcome to the Weird Things Podcast. I'm Andrew Main, joined by Brian Brushwood.
Yo is the way I greet everybody.
Mr. Justin Robert Young.
Oh, is how I've been known to greet everybody.
And joining Brian, I was waiting for him to take a big sip, Captain Murphy himself.
Jason Murphy. Funny noise here. I don't have anything.
Like, how does
Jason
this go?
Jason Murphy in the studio with Brian.
Yeah, man. We didn't know for sure, since this was Justin's big bachelor party weekend, whether or not he would be, well, A, alive, or B, capable of joining us. So we, since Jason was over here, we thought we'd bring him back to the show. You've been on the show before, right?
Yes.
I like that. I'm sorry to interrupt. Go ahead.
No, it's okay.
Like,
no. That, go ahead.
I like that Justin's pinch hitters are two Irish guys.
That's how we go.
The only time I was on here was years ago, when Andrew couldn't show up.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Okay. I bet that was a train wreck.
it was kind of awful.
That was back when we thought that could happen.
We started stabbing at each other and trying to fight for gas. And...
Well, you guys might have to step up, because I think next Sunday I am going to be traveling through the air during the time. So.
Uh-oh. All right. We'll figure something out.
Going to go to Nuevo York. Go see two upstarts make their Broadway debut.
Oh, doggone it. Are you going to see Penn & Teller on Broadway?
I am, sir.
I wanted to see if I could take Bonnie, and Bonnie's schedule didn't permit. I was like, oh, well. But then, like, now I have the itch where it's like, maybe I'll just up and spend points and just run out. When are you going next Sunday?
The third is where I'm going to go see, right, but Sunday. Okay. Yeah, I made a choice between either, like, my best friend in the world, you know, my hetero soulmate's bachelor party, or next week going to see Penn & Teller.
Well,
Fine. No, it's great. Well, actually, we'll put together a little special episode of the show, because Brian and I will be in Utah for Nerdtacular.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. So if it's the third, I can't. But I wonder if there's some point during the run I can run up there for just a night and turn around and come back.
This is a great new segment on the show called Brian's Google Calendar.
That's right.
Interactive tour through when Brian's busy and when he has available time.
I'm going to jump right just in says here, Hearthstone. Folks. For audio listeners, you're not. You probably can pick it up in the tone of my voice. You can probably sense it. There's probably some way in which it's been affected. For those of you watching right now, there may be a glow about me.
I mean, you actually, you do. You look flushed. You look frothy. Wow.
You look radiant.
You look like freshly churned butter.
Guys, what have you done with your hair?
You look like you're ready to fight. Show enough.
That was fantastic, Sam's. I had... I'm not quite ready to fight show enough, okay? Need Bruce Leroy for that. I had an experience, folks. I had a transcendent, incredible experience Friday by myself. Well, nobody was within arm's distance of me.
Practically by yourself.
Yes.
Yeah, by 1880s standards, you were alone in the wilderness.
So we've talked about virtual reality before, and we've talked about experiences doing Oculus Rift. And I like how when you talk about the different headsets, it's like you're talking about drugs, you know?
Yeah.
Oh, have you done Molly? Yeah. Have you done the Galaxy Gear? Yeah, you know, I'm going to get some X, you know?
Have you done Red Beavis?
Like, we've all done Oculus, right?
No, I still have not. The closest I have come, yeah, I've not done Oculus. The closest I've come was when I accidentally stole Justin's Google Cardboard thing, built it, made it, tried it, thought it was cool, dude, and that's all I've done.
Come to rates, like Jeff has an Oculus dev kit.
All right.
Yeah. Duh. Dumbass. So we've done that, tried that. I mean, those of us here, and then you've tried like the cardboard, and you can actually on Amazon, you can buy like the new upgraded cardboard that'll let you use the iPhone, because now cardboard works on iOS too. And so like I just ordered for $20 one that's a plastic one that fits over your head. But I'm not here to talk about that. I went down to Venice Beach, you know, the new Silicon Beach, and I went to a place called WeVR, WEVR, and they were doing an open house. And what they're working on is they're working on a platform. So if you want to create content more like immersive video content, and you want to make sure that it's going to output to whatever formats, because right now in the space to control your eyeballs, we know about Oculus Rift, which is now a Facebook company. We know about Samsung has the Gear, which you plug your phone into and you can do that. And there's the Google Cardboard, which you can do. There is coming out, you know, we know, of course, Microsoft has augmented reality with HoloLens. That's another system. And then there's been talk about HTC, the company came out with that, announced Vive. And they partnered with Steam. As you know, Steam, which is the big, huge video game distribution platform. So Steam said, hey, we'll handle the software. You guys handle the hardware. Let's put our peanut butter and chocolate together and see what kind of magic we can make. And they unveiled this. And everybody has a slightly different approach. You know, Oculus is kind of like it's developed by hardcore gamers. You know, you've got Palmer Luckey, you've got John Carmack, you know, legendary gamer. They've developed a system. I have Rev2 development kit and played with that, and it's really cool tech. I got my first chance to try the HTC Vive on Friday.
So, and just to further fill out how crowded this market is, Sony has done Morpheus, right?
Morpheus, yes, correct. That's the other one I forgot to add.
So this is pretty much anybody who wants to plant a flag in video games specifically, for the next 10 years, is taking a stab
and
at a big top shelf virtual reality.
I have one
right now.
It's beer goggles.
that's your development. It alters your reality.
Yeah.
Real quick, I heard you rattle off a bunch of them. In there was both HoloLens and the Magic Leap, or was that a different category for you?
Nobody has tried Magic Leap outside of a laboratory, and there's no shipping date yet. And those HoloLens and Magic Leap are augmented reality, where you see the world around you and it overlays. The other ones, which, you know, Morpheus, Gear, Oculus, and Vive are all immersive, just shut out the world, you're in there, right? So I got to do the Vive demo. Now, what makes this different is when you normally do the Oculus, you're sitting down. There's a little tracker that sees which way your head is moving in space, 3D space. But it's kind of a state, as it is right now, it's a stationary experience, and they haven't really defined the controller. What they did with the Vive, and the Vive will probably be, they're saying the Vive is going to be more expensive, be much more expensive. But the Vive is, you put this headset on, You have these two wands with these things you can click with these octagonal little sensors on top of it that are really good for sensing in space, and you put two sensors up on your walls near your ceiling in your room. What this does is it tracks your head and your movement in three-dimensional space so you can stand and you can walk around. If you approach a wall, this blue grid flashes in front of you that's like,
oh, that lets you know that you're about to encounter an object in real space.
Yes, yes, exactly. So you can say, my room is this big, my room is X big, or whatever like that. But what it does is instead of you sitting there and feeling like you're popping your head into a 3D world, it puts that 3D world around where you are. So I'm like, I'm waiting in line to go do this thing, and I'm like, listen, guys, I'm not Oculus.
I mean, you've already picked a team in this. You're like, sorry, bro. I understand it's called the Pepsi Challenge, but I'm a Coke man, and I'm always going to be a Coke man.
I didn't pick, but I'm like, every experience I've done has been sort of incremental. Like, oh, this is cool. In Oculus, I go like, oh, this is cool. I can see, like, if I was a gamer, I would love this. You know, an Oculus Rift would be great. I've seen, like, if I were a gamer, this would be a cool way to play this. Put on the Vive, right? The Vive comes on, thing goes up. And now I'm, like, looking around, and I'm used to kind of, like, Oculus sort of just sort of looking around like this, you know, kind of, you know, Batman 1989 Tim Burton mode, you know,
with the stiff, locked neck, yeah.
And I'm in a room that's, I guess it's based on Portal. It's called Aperture, and so I'm in this bay.
Aperture Sciences. Yeah, no, this it's adorable. It's adorable.
this is amazing because I don't even know what Andrew's about to say, but I know specifically for Jason and Brian, it's just like so. Anyway, I went to this place. Disneyland, it had it's something about it. Tomorrow.
I saw Bugs Bunny there.
Yeah,
Bunny was.
So you were put in
the lab.
Yeah,
after labs.
You're in the lab. You have these controllers, which then come up. They then become these sort of grips. And his voice is, "All right, step over to this wall and pull out these trays." Like, I look over and I'm reaching my arms out. I can't reach it. So I'm like, oh, maybe I need to walk over. So I walk over to the wall, and next to the wall. I take my little pincers, and I grab the tray, slide it open.
Now, okay, so first of all, this is a no-no in Oculus land. You don't physically get up and walk anywhere. All the Oculus stuff we've seen have been put yourself in a thing where you can pretend to walk forward or use keyboard and mouse or whatever. You physically walked in this space and encountered an actual wall at the right spot.
Interacted with it in a way that, like, he physically was brought to a point and then interacted with it, which is something.
I pull out this tray and I look down as people go running around, and I'm like, oh, this is cool. This would make a great game one day, right? Shut the drawer, and it says go over to the other bay door and pull the handle. So I go over there, and you're using these controllers. We're kind of like Wii Wand sort of clicker things. And in the virtual space, you see, like, these robot hands. I go over there, grab a handle, and again, physically walk over to the space. I'm not like, oh, let me hit the right button on my keyboard or go over there. I'm like, no, I just effing walk over there, reach over, pull the handle down. All of a sudden, the door goes, and there's a robot that needs to be serviced. Comes into the room, and I back up to make room for the robot, undo the panel. Next thing you know, they start playing the manual, like, oh, be sure to fix the 2:1 or 2:0, but don't forget to do this. And so it's kind of a joke because it's, you know, the humor of the game.
Right.
So next thing you know, you're trying to operate on things and doing mechanically, like, fix and tweak things. And so – and I stepped back because this robot was, like, filling – and I had to, like, tell myself, no, you can walk through that space. It's okay. It's not real. So that was that experience, okay? And, this would be the demo, I think, that we're playing here.
Yeah, yeah, our fabulous producer, Neshcom. And for those of you who are gamers, it looks like it's Atlas of Atlas and Peabody from Portal 2.
Oh, my God.
What you're seeing there, I'm there. I was there watching this, and you're looking all the way around. What's great about the Vive is its refresh rate is 90 frames per second, right?
Oh, tasty.
There was no latency. I can't go on Star Tours because I get motion sickness. Before this, me and some people were talking about, like, well, how long will you be able to sit in a VR experience? What's the length of time on that? Whatever. When I went into this and I talked to my buddy who I went there with, afterwards, like, we could have done this for hours. So, yeah, I did the same thing right now. You're seeing this handle grab this lever and pull it down. And this is – it's photorealistic.
Oh my gosh.
No, I literally thought this when we started playing this, that this was just footage from a garage, like it just in that first shot, because the lighting like was just so amazing. Like it looked so good. It kind of looked dingy. You're just taking cell phone videos like initially before the magic happens.
My buddy I brought with me is Ken Gust. He's with Synaptics Effects. One of his partners, Sean, was a guy that worked on Troops. The Stormtrooper, you know, short stuff. So his big VFX guy. I told Ken, I'm like, do this demo first because it's photorealistic. If you told me, hey, we're gonna put some goggles on your head and we're gonna put some high quality video cameras in front and we're just gonna feed you a tap of what's right in front of you,
yeah.
That's what it felt like. It felt like it was a real place. It was not, it's like a wraparound monitor. I'm looking. It was a real place. The next demo, I'm on the deck of a sunken ship, right?
Uh-huh.
And I'm watching manta rays glide around me, blue whales go by, and the only thing missing was I wanted to feel like water or waves or whatever on me, but it was intense. I mean, it's just a thing. Ken's friend, his girlfriend Patricia, she'd gone swimming with manta rays, and she came out of that like, oh my god, that just took me back to a magical time and place when I did that, you know. And you can go to the edge of the bow of the ship and look over, and you get vertigo because all of a sudden you just see
down
this drop way below you, right?
So in terms of the spatial element, it takes an inventory of the room that you're in. And then just gives you subtle cues when you're too far, but like, does it shape the world to fit the room?
So I don't know. I think with the first demo, the portal type demo, I think that it could adjust the size of the room to where you are. And I found myself, I had a lot more room to walk in than I did, and we're upstairs in a sweaty loft, and it can do that. I did a demo at the MXR lab at USC last year where it would shape, you would walk into a room and then you'd go to leave. They would move the door when you're looking away behind you so you could exit. So you were able to go through an entire Afghani village searching for weapons inside.
And it would just keep shaping. It's sort of like when you play Call of Duty, they call that kind of game on rails because, you feel like you're choosing to go left or right, but really it's just tunneling you down a corridor.
Right.
But you experience that in real time.
With this, what they're going to be able to do, like, you know, if, you know, people, some people like who haven't done, like, yeah, but what if I can't keep running? Like, no, you're not, you can't keep running, but you might be able to get to a spot and then jog in place and then get to another spot and then do combat or whatever in free space and not you'll treadmills and stuff like that, maybe, but this was incredible. So the next thing I did after that, everything goes dark. And then I'm in a room that feels like a real darkened room.
By the way, I would imagine that they're pretty good at simulating since you're wearing goggles over your eyeballs.
But I could see things. I could see walls. I could see stuff like that.
It would be just dark.
If you stepped into a room with like a nightlight. One hand has this color wheel. The other hand, the wand is glowing. It's a glowing paintbrush that glows, that makes this glow paint in midair. So when I press, if I touch blue and I go like make a line across there, I make a blue line.
And this
now
is,
I step to the side, it's in completely in 3D. So I started drawing like letters in space and then walked around them. I could draw clouds. I could draw raindrops in three-dimensional space, then walk through the raindrops.
So, okay. And what I love most about this is that it sounds to me, if I'm hearing you describe it correctly, or if I'm hearing you correctly, like the objects that you're holding are the same shape and size as the objects as you perceive them, right?
Relative. They make them feel consistent. But the incredible thing is like, so imagine you're painting in three-dimensional space and you can walk through and interact with it. It's sick. It was just incredible. So once I got stepped out of this thing, my experience was this is something, it's not just something I would buy to develop for or experiment with. This is something I would buy to play with and to have fun with. Like, you know, a game like Arkham Knights looks cool to me, but to play Arkham Knights in a system like this where you're going to stand there and look around and actually be in Gotham, holy crap. It was as profound as an experience as like the first time I ever – and now what you're watching a demo right now. We're watching a guy playing in black and white. What I did was far more advanced than this. It was colors, multiple colors. You could see his physical sense of the space in the room around you. I could make like a, you know, a field of grass that you could walk through in real time. Wow. And you look at that and you think of how even simple things like Minecraft became a juggernaut because it said, you know what, PCs are fast enough that we can now, you know, create these realistic 3D environments, you know, good enough 3D environments that you can interact and shape and control.
Right.
In VR, it's going to get sick.
It changes everything, really. I mean, it's not just gaming. This is a lot of people don't get it unless they've experienced it. Most people that I'm talking to, they really don't understand that, okay, everybody just thinks, oh, it's the Virtual Boy. It's Lawnmower Man, you know?
Yeah.
That's what everybody thinks. But no, this is punctuated evolution in technology.
This really will become this is as important as when we saw, you know, and I don't know who gets credit for it, but you know, the desktop interface that we associated with the Mac. I mean, this will become the preferred environment to design and develop as brains, you know, and again, we're all too old. We're going to be dead, dumb corpses by the time that this becomes the de facto standard. Meanwhile, like my children are going to grow up expecting that this is the way that it's like, God, why are we typing with keyboards? It's so dumb. Why are we drawing with mouses, with mice? It's so dumb.
I don't know. I mean, I think it's going to be part of the experience. I think it certainly is going to be part of it. And when I was in there, I'm thinking, you know, I wanted to check my Apple Watch to look at the time, and I'm like, man, you know, we're not – I don't think you're going to want to re-engineer Facebook so everybody can go into 3D to do Facebook, but you're going to want to have a version of Facebook that works when you're in that world.
Well, to me, it's the difference between getting grown-up business done on my phone versus my desktop. For example, Jason and I just spent 2.5 hours working on this pitch for a thing, and he physically came over to my house because we knew that for the two of us, it was going to be better for us to sit there and actually, you know, Photoshop this, type this out, you know, talk back and forth or whatever. The desktop is the superior platform for creative endeavors right now, but for some creative endeavors, nothing will compare to this again.
When we can all hop into there and we can all of a sudden explore shared spaces, you know, because I like the room where you paint with. I said, man, if we had like Minecraft Legos in there and the four of us could jump inside of there and start building like we did when we were kids, but bigger ones, and make machines to go to war with each other.
Right. Well,
invite everybody in Diamond Realm to show up on a virtual field. I went to bed that night thinking about the fact that every one of those spaces I went to felt like a real space. It felt like a real place. And the idea that when we think about what Snow Crash talked about and the concept of what happens when these virtual places just aren't these siloed different degrees of interactions with just a computer program, but when they feel like real physical spaces. And you know, do we start saying, you know, does Warcraft become a planet?
Well,
and not just separate servers, but no, we'll have separate continents or whatever here, but this is a planet and we start connecting these spaces together. It just gets insane.
So here's the biggest thing that is just kind of becoming clear to me is we right now have a moment in popular culture for like conventions, right? We're all going to be at Dragon Con. We very much love the idea of a suspended universe where a lot of these things are real, you know, like Renaissance fairs are a similar idea. Like, if this is the mainstream, moment for the idea that, like, this isn't just a special place that you have to travel for, you can live in these worlds without the, like, yeah, you know, it's cool, but sort of hangover of where even advanced VR now tends to be, that's gigantic.
Well, what I found is that it's so easy to trick your brain that the photorealistic graphics that you were talking about in the Portal simulation, that's great, but in my experience with the Oculus Rift, wholly unnecessary. It's amazing, and I'd love to see it, but everything that I've experienced, it was like a low-res, almost like a 16-bit or maybe like an N64-era replication of walking around the Millennium Falcon. Yeah. And it was wholly immersive, and when things shifted, I would, you know, steady myself, and so like the graphical fidelity was
less important to you than just the immersiveness, yes, the head tracking and stuff. Yeah,
exactly. I yeah, to your point, Jason, I think there, you, once you click a certain couple of things, the experience becomes really cool. But there is that difference between, you know, for me, it was, I didn't feel like I was sticking my, like at the edge of the pool, sticking my head underwater, looking under the water and seeing the fish. I felt like I was in the pool. You know, I mean, it is, I hate metaphors, but it was a, it was a next, it was just that it wasn't, I was not, the connection between me and the space evaporated. Not that I was just felt like I was dipping into it, but it just evaporated where I was in that space.
So here, let's, as we tend to do on Weird Things, let's project kind of what the consequences of this kind of technology are in the future.
It occurs, total loss of productivity.
I would say total gain of productivity, but, no. Imagine this, imagine a world where when you buy a house, just like when, you know, for our entire lifetimes, sort of your ability to, if you had disposable income, you would, and you were buying a TV, you would, all things being equal, you would buy the biggest display you're able to afford for the highest fidelity experience, right? So imagine a world when you buy spaces or when you rent apartments. One of the things nowadays, the big thing is bandwidth. You know, it's like you will pick an apartment because they offer gigabit versus only, you know, 10 megabit, whatever crap. I can imagine a world where it's like, oh, and this one has a holotarium of over 75 by 75 feet wide. So you get a very high fidelity experience. And then, you know, if you need to, you will, you know, there will be giant shared spaces that you could run entire football fields at a time.
Well, in that respect, that's kind of a step backwards, though, right? I mean, especially as space becomes at a premium, like in, you know, Tokyo, for instance. Aren't we looking at, wouldn't the ideal manifestation of this be where you no space at all is required?
Well, theoretically.
You know, we can, yeah, but I mean, you know, before we get to there, there's a lot of here. There's a lot of, there's a lot of just between here and there. And, you know, we, there will be no final form of it. And I think that what we're going to see, like the product I saw, they said they're going to try to have shipping end of year, right? They want to have end of year, you'll be able to buy this thing and do this thing.
Christmas this year.
Yeah, this year. And they, it may slip to early next year, but their goal is to have it where on the shelves, you can go buy this thing this year. Which the first thing that's going to happen is we're going to get rid of our goddamn coffee tables.
Dude, we're going to need room to run around. And you're right. The living room is the obvious choice for everyone to install these. All of a sudden, people are going to figure out a lot of places they can wedge those couches.
Murphy beds are going to become popular.
Now's the time to leverage that name.
Yes. The empire of collapsible beds.
These are approved Murphy beds.
Exactly.
Yeah, it's hard. I mean, we can think in a lot of ways. I can think that, you know, from a personal point of view, the kind of interactions I had, now that we're watching video of this paint thing, which is nowhere near as exciting as what, and it's, this is, looks is all wireframe. What I saw was full color in a room. It's like we said, let's dim the lights a bit and paint in the middle of space with glowing wands. I'm excited about the idea of, you know, somebody's going to build a virtual Disneyland. And what is a virtual Disneyland going to be? You know, we can Pirates of the Caribbean. It doesn't have to be. And again, gaming, I'm not a big gamer, so I try to look at it from a different kind of context.
Sure. But it's about storytelling and situations. Now, in fact, just the other night, I got into a discussion with someone. You know, we were talking about environmentalism, but it's like, I mean, do you think in the future that we're going to bother to build physical Disneylands? Eventually you will have the amount of resources that go into all of Disney World, all of the worlds around it. That level of human effort will go into a completely virtual theme park.
But it
that
won't.
Will
it
pay
won't
to
eliminate
to.
The other though. Escalators have obviated stairs.
That is correct. But what I'm saying is like we can now have a rich, rich experience with literally or virtually zero environmental impact whatsoever. You don't even need to build the things.
We will have awesome experiences there, but we still, going to see live sports is still a $1 billion thing, even though what you watch at home is a much better experience.
Sure. Well, those will be the expensive seats. Those will be the premium seats. Those will be the thing that the super rich get to brag. Well, it's like, yeah, but I was actually there. Meanwhile, the hoi polloi will all be able to spend $5 and get a front row center court seat at the NBA finals, you know?
Well, extrapolating it, will we be getting rid of most of the things that we see around us, like, you know, the art hanging in our rooms. Well, we just have, okay, you know what? I don't need anything but something to keep my food cold and my you know, a shower and, like, basically a box. I just need a big box.
And to your point, Jason, you know, one of the things I talk to some of my friends who employ, like, younger people, like 20-year-olds or whatever, they talk about how when somebody has their Netflix account, their HBO account, and their online access in their phone, they don't have the same concept of materialism that a generation did before them. And right. So, yeah.
Here's my question for you, Andrew. If this is going to go on sale in December, is this a possible, like, you know, on the scale of zero to Nintendo Wii when it first came out, being kind of this, it was away from where the trend of console gaming was going, which was, you know, more speed, more power, and was instead relying on a whole new way of interacting with games. Is this something that could make a mainstream impact?
You know, I think yes. The answer to that is going to be that it's Oculus is going to price itself to try to get as many hands as possible. So everybody already has a fast gaming rig. Oculus will be attractive. Vive will be more expensive, but I think that there's going to be the debate, you know, which do you want? If you just want to sit in a chair and, you know, you're a keyboard type gamer, getting up and doing those kind of experiences won't be the same for you. There's going to be different things, but I think both of them are going to have a profound impact on how people interact. I think Vive is exciting because if the only time you use a keyboard is to write email and enter in search engines, and the rest of the time you want to kind of just be in three-dimensional meat space, the Vive is going to be exciting. I think we're going to start looking at non-gaming stuff, but it's going to be the one that I think many lay people will put on and go, holy cow, I get this now, and I kind of get why gamers get what they get out of a game.
Well, the key is getting it into people's hands. I've talked to so many people, mostly gamers, who don't get it. Even if I'm explaining to them, no, it's amazing, they still are thinking, like I said earlier, Virtual Boy or Lawnmower Man or the stuff you experience at the mall. And it's hard to really sell it to someone without them experiencing one of the models.
Exactly. And, you know, I saw, like, on Verge or whatever, they talked about demoing the Vive, and you would see some people like, nope, Oculus for me. I don't need, you know, who needs to do this the room or whatever. It's like, great, but just try.
It's so amazing to me. Here's the thing: is this not even out?
Yeah,
I know. But this is the console wars mentality, right? This is, and it all goes down to we're all still 7 years old. Everyone who participates in a console war is still a 7 year old who knows he can only ask Santa for either an Xbox or a PlayStation, and he has to choose. And then once you choose, you have to fight really hard because the worst thing you could possibly acknowledge is that you made the wrong choice to Santa that one time.
There's going to be, like, I love going to planetariums. Planetariums, I think, are one of these underappreciated forms of media that we have, because you go in there, you sit down, we recreate the entire universe on this dome, and a really good planetarium show can be a transcendent experience. You start thinking about creating those kinds of experiences for something like Vive or Oculus or whatever, and you put this on somebody like, oh, hey, guess what? We got virtual Carl Sagan to explain the universe to you takes you on a cosmic odyssey.
Yeah. Well, and again, that's the down the road stuff. Like right now, it's almost a bit of a crime that the way this begins is with, you know, crass, visceral entertainment. You know, it's like what this will mean down the road to have. Imagine if we were able to start recording back in the day, and nowadays you could take a class by actual Leonardo da Vinci in his actual studio, actually walking you through everything. I mean, it's this is where you keep thinking like, oh, history began at blank. And it's like, you know, there are those who will say history really begins with Fidelity, you know, this year.
The demo we see right now, that's like what I saw. That was what I was doing, where I was painting in three-dimensional space with glowing lines like that.
It's significantly improved from the other demo that we saw.
And the experience, too, is like we're watching the sort of the virtual camera move around. But when it's you motivating the movement, when you're just leaning, it's like when you watch somebody else, you put a camera on, put a GoPro on somebody else's head and they move around.
Yeah.
You're like, okay. But when it's you moving in and doing and motivating the movement, it's real.
Well, that,
it's
amazing. And that's, I remember realizing, you know, about 10 years ago, I was playing Oblivion and I was just, you know, marveling at how good the sunsets looked and how, you know, rich the environments were. And I realized that, you know, I was like, well, to my wife, you know, she is blind in one eye. So she experiences all of 3D is 3D to her thanks to the motion of parallax, right? Which is that linking of you initiate a movement and then the relative motion between everything, clouds move at a different speed than the tree right next to you and so on. I would imagine that especially at that high refresh, that having that sense of creating parallax is just as important, if not more, than having two eyes and stereoscopic vision.
Oh, yeah. It just, you know, people who have like only sight in one eye, they'll do the thing where they tilt their head back and forth, you know, they do that little thing to create the simulation. And this would work. All those things, all those cues are there, just the subtle movement of your head back and forth, adjusting it. It's so, anyhow, to sum up, holy crap.
Sorry. I really apologize. And I want your opinion on this, Andrew, because watching that demo, that the art demo, it's like immediate. I just want to, for everybody who is just listening to this, like you need to, we need to maybe throw the link in the show notes or whatever. But like, I could see, you know, you put just a baseline kind of rule element. Like this is the building element of Minecraft, like an art world where you can make literally whatever you want, and then your friends can walk through it and stuff like that, or you can build it together. It is mind-blowing. This is fantastic.
Now, speaking, this is going to sound stereotypically me, and I'm seriously not doing that, but much like with Blu-rays and DVDs and the internet, is the success of one of these virtual realities or just the whole platform going to be buttressed by pornography?
Oh, in the hugest way. And in fact, there's some funny videos where I believe they collected a bunch of rap stars, they put Oculus Rift on them, and then they showed them 360 degree visual porn, and it's all point of view stuff, and you know, these are people who know that there are cameras on them,
yeah,
who are just like one of them at one point says, well, I deeply regret wearing sweatpants right now.
Well, when you're able to put on a pair of goggles,
sure,
and hold some sticks and have sex with Scarlett Johansson, it's gonna make heroin look like Diet Coke.
So hypothetically, I may know somebody who's tried some of those VR porn experiences, and they are very intense. But there has been an overstatement of like a technology catches on when porn gets into it, because everything, you know, every porn tries to get onto everything, every form of technology, DivX, the original DivX, all that stuff.
Oh my gosh!
And
yeah.
So it can often be this. Well, porn's tried to support a lot of things that could never work. We will, as long as we've had charcoal and cave walls, we've been creating porn.
Yeah.
There is not an invention that we have not tried to bang. That was, yeah. So does it work? Great. Can I have sex with it?
The success of the technology isn't if we can put porn onto it, because there are many, many crush technologies that people try.
But will it support the technology until the mainstream catches on?
I wouldn't count on.
No, that I think that's
vice versa.
Yeah. It's got to be mainstream, and then, you know, porn can make it more.
But there's already a lawsuit flying from a teledildonics company suing other ones for claiming.
I know, I saw that.
Is it really?
Yeah. There's a patent. We got a patent war.
I had a friend who I've been talking some of these projects with. He says, you know, I ran into Rocco Siffredi at a store, and I was thinking, you know, if we wanted to, we could talk to him about it. I'm like, it's not an area I want to get into.
Man. LA's a fun town.
Hey,
I was at a party Friday night with a kangaroo.
Dang it, dude! Talk about burying the lead. you tell us your story about going to Silicon Beach, and then you get around to mentioning you partied with a kangaroo. Or you
can't. It was a Back to the Future party on a castle overlooking the Hollywood Hills, overlooking Los Angeles, and I get there at crazy LA type thing, and my buddy goes, oh yeah, did you even see the kangaroo? I'm like, ha ha, kangaroo. I'm walking down some steps, I see a fence, and I see an emu running by.
What?
Like, oh, okay. And I look over, and there in the corner, they say it's a Joey or whatever, but like a little kangaroo is kind of cowering in the corner, just like, are they gone yet?
Holy cow. Are you able to share the details of why that was, or was that part of the mystique of the party?
The kangaroo was their pet.
You know what's funny is when you said a castle overlooking Hollywood Hills, I thought that you were talking about the magic castle. I was like, some event.
This is a different castle. Yeah, there was an actual DeLorean set up like Back to the Future there. Crazy. Everybody was like Back to the Future attire. I wore two ties and in my pockets inside out.
Oh, that's amazing.
Folks, you too can support Andrew Main's Caligula-esque extravagant LA lifestyle by going to patreon.com/weirdthings. That is where we support the show. If you head on over there right now, you will understand that you could be part of an army of 463 patrons kicking in money that helps us pay for Bryce Neshcom Castillo to make sure that we are having a show every week and we know what the hell we're talking about and we're gathering up emails and stuff like that. So go ahead and check us out. That is patreon.com/weirdthings.
Oh, yeah. So, hey, I had something that I wanted to chit-chat with you guys about. I don't know if either of you guys listened to it, but lately I've been on a binge. Actually, thanks to your co-host on Rage Select, Jeff got me listening to the Cracked.com podcast.
Oh, yeah, it's great.
And the guy who writes as David Wong, Jason Parjan, I think his name is. There was an episode, I'm getting caught up, from like 4 months ago or whatever, and they're talking about artificial racial constructs and sexism constructs, and the reason that we need to get rid of them is not so much because you owe a debt or it's somehow your fault that your great 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 grandfather owned slaves or whatever, but because where you are now is a side effect of where you came from. And basically it portrayed everyone as a leaf on a tree, right? It said you are a leaf on a tree and you are the result of everything that happened before you, so it's not a tree's fault that it ran into this one place, but it is the tree's responsibility to correct its growth or whatever. Sure. Right? And at some point, offhandedly, to explain it, they said, like, look how racist ants are. And by which they meant the moment an ant encounters another ant.
My aunt says horrible stuff about my niece all the time.
And they say the ants in general.
My aunt is a huge Hulk Hogan fan.
And they said at some point, offhandedly, ants are very racist if they encounter a slightly different ant, by which I assume let's mean an ant of another species, they will immediately attack it and they'll go to war and they'll fight and they'll slay the other one, right? He says, if all the ants were to get on the same team and take out humanity, we would absolutely lose.
I've seen that movie.
Exactly, right? But it got me thinking, like, you hear that, you're
so
like...
Fast.
The first thing you think of is then they put up the statistics that there is literally for every human. I want to ask you guys, for every human on Earth, how many ants do you think there are, Jason? Realistic answer, your true answer. Yeah.
I'm gonna go for every human.
For every human, for you like, personally.
For me, I'm gonna say like I'm gonna go high. I'm gonna go like 5 million.
All right, Justin.
I'm gonna go. 4.99 million.
What is this? Price is Right?
It's reverse. It's the worst version of Price is Right ever. Andrew?
100,000.
It is 10 million ants for every living human on the planet, right? So here's this got me thinking, like, okay, realistically, let's say right now a lightning bolt strikes, all ants become agreed. They're not brilliant. They're not smart. They're not much smarter than they are right now. The one thing they agree on is that we're all on the same team and that we have one goal to universally wipe out humanity, right? So they can't do anything they couldn't do now. Number one, how much of mankind gets wiped out and do the ants ultimately win in general, full stop? Now, again, we're looking at I'm sure someone in the chat could give us the total number of ants on the entire planet, because here's what got me thinking about it is there are two things. Number one, let's say they immediately start attacking. And I would imagine that if their goal was to kill humans, that most rural areas would immediately become ant seeded. They would have control of all rural areas. Yeah. But then now they're able to reproduce and use 100% of all the land. So their numbers become even higher.
Exponentially.
And then, and so I'm thinking, like, in my mind, I'm thinking, like, what, okay, well, first of all, tell me where your guys' minds are at. What are the first things that happen?
I'm just thinking that is why the FBI keeps asking me why I'm making napalm in my garage all the time. It's for this.
Justin?
So we've locked down the scenario. We know where we're playing inside. The question is, how bad would a united ant invasion front be?
And how bad would it be? Would they possibly full on win, or does our intellect allow us to win? And if so, in what practical measures can we take? And I'm sure Andrew already has plans that he's formulating about nuking stuff from space, just to be sure. But in the short term, I would imagine, yes, it's every ant disaster movie we've seen. It's Kingdom of the Spiders. It's all that stuff. Only I would imagine with a lot more losses. And once the losses happen, I would imagine they would become total just because they have the numbers. You know, once the small town of Round Rock, Texas falls, I don't see a couple of lone survivors hanging in there.
Well, I don't even know if it'll get that bad. I mean, what kind of warning do we have? I mean, that's the big
zero
one, right?
Warning. Like one day they quietly have all decided.
If it just immediately starts happening, we could be screwed.
Well, okay.
Well, all right. So let's try to wrap our head around conceptually what this looks like. Effectively, it's just a rising tide of ants that if you get near, will consume, right? Or it will consume as high as that tide is, and we're assuming that it is growing. That like. So an ant-controlled small Texas town would be a town that literally has ants all over it. Like, that is consumed by ants, right? Because it's not like they're like, picking off the people because they know that, like, those are strategic assets to, you know, for their survival and winning of the war. This is a brute-strength invasion.
Yes. I all the ants know is ants are bros, and humans need to be eaten, right? And so, I don't know. Andrew, where's your head at on this?
I'm already writing this in my head for the novel. There was a book, Saul Bass, the legendary designer, AT&T logo, all these, you know, these graphic, one of the most famous ever. He directed one movie.
Yep.
Phase 4, all about this. And in answer to your question, I think that the one thing we have helping us is ants don't do well in really cold weather climates.
Okay.
So if they attack us in mass at once, you know, yeah, we could be screwed. You know, we start, you know, red ants start biting us and killing us and then going after us eating our food. But there will be pockets of humanity in places where there are no ants. And I got to think our ant pesticide development is going to increase dramatically. And we're going to try to say, like, screw them.
We will kill these. Okay, as will the collateral damage, though.
Oh! Environmental damage, tremendous.
So talk us through this. Give us the Andrew Main novel. Give us the arcs. Right. Like, what cities fall?
So here's opening scene. President's killed by ants. Also the vice president. Also the entire line of people that would take over for president. And in a bizarre bylaw of the Constitution, it says the person who just released Name of the Devil, available now at Amazon, you know, becomes president. Andrew Main ascends to the highest position of power. How do you repel this ant attack?
By the way, of course, reporting for duty is your cabinet, Brian, Justin, and why?
How long have we known each other?
We're all going to die.
God damn it.
We're all going to die. I'm going to throw my body onto an anthill right now and, so here's what happens. You have this sort of thing happen. You know, this thing takes place. Let's say it's just like red ants, whatever, that's all around you. They just get extremely predatory. They start seeking people out, killing them. They still need food. They still have to move in mass from place to place to do this. What I would do, I mean, number one, what's going to happen is, what are going to be the places that are going to be safe already? Our Navy, for the most part. You know, there might be ants on board, whatever, but there's going to be, hey, kill all the ants, protect your food, whatever. All of our ships at sea going to be safe for a while, okay? Certain military facilities, some of our biolabs, things like that are going to be functioning. We identify right now that it's ants, and we start thinking, where is it really cold? Where are these colder climates?
Before we get there, how bad, what percentage of American lives right now on, we'll just say the continental United States, or we'll just say American lives, full stop, what percentage are lost? How bad is this attack?
I think, I would have to try to figure out, how many red ants are around you that could kill you? How many ants are around you that are capable of killing you? What's the loss of life in the first hour, the first 24 hours? What's the loss of life in the next 7 days?
And how many stings does it take to kill a healthy human adult? Well,
Brian, you got a backyard.
Why
don't we guys do an experiment?
Oh, jeez. I'll go roll around. I'm like, hey, guys.
And this is, by the way, using ants for malicious purposes is a side plot line in my new book I just turned into my agent.
Oh, that's awesome. Nice. Tom Adana says from the chat, this is unverified until we see a source on it, but he says 1,000 bites from any ants will kill you, whether or not they're poisonous.
This was the same person in the chat room who said that his plan was we all gather in one area and build a giant magnifying glass to fry the ants.
Well, okay, first of all, that's a legit plan, and Mr. President, I'd like to suggest we build a giant magnifying glass immediately.
I, for one, welcome our new ant overlords.
I think that we're going to start, I think there could be a lot. We have to. I mean, I don't know. I have no clue to tell you how deadly would it be if they all tried to kill us. Word would get around fast. Hey, listen, ants are killing people. Something's got driving them berserk. Stay away from ants. Figure out how you can kill them. What are you going to do to spread around your floor to do that? And we go to war.
Yeah. I mean, effectively, it becomes chemical and sonic warfare. Right. I feel like that's what we do immediately is we start, finding out in your household what can be the most effective mass ant killer. We become a lot more lax on inhaling poisons and we just start, throwing any and everything that we can.
And our war against the ants leads to complete colony collapse.
There we go. They were like, hey, man, how are we killing those bees? Let's double down on all that, people.
Yeah.
Well, got to read Matt Ridley's observations on the bee thing, by the way.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's I'd say it's not as perhaps dire as people make it out to be, and the neo-Nick stuff is probably based on faulty research, and one of the biggest things contributing to that is how beekeepers will travel their bees tremendous distances, which fatigue them and then expose them to fungus that they're not used to. And
interesting.
It's more complicated than we'd like. And it's not to say, hey, everything's fine, but Matt Ridley, rationaloptimist.com, type in colony collapse.
I want to read World War A as written by Andrew Main, because that's what this sounds like.
Funny is yesterday I was thinking about I love those stories Planet of the Apes, apes go crazy. Jurassic Park, apes go crazy. Patterson has zoo, animal. I'm like, and then zombies. I'm like, man, I want to write something where there's something eating us or killing us. And I'm in my head as you're talking about this, I'm like, how do I make ants interesting? I'm thinking what I could do too is like the ants that drive people animals crazy or something too. Is that
the ones that infect with an ant with some kind of hallucinogenic compound that allowed them to enough of them sting that it causes them similar to The Last of Us
cordyceps.
with fungus okay, so if I'm hearing the consensus seems to be between the four of us that I'm going to go out and say a good 2/3 of humanity. I say it's a pretty big hit, even if we have good intellectual hygiene and we get the word out fast and everyone uses their pesticides, I'd say we lose everything north or everything between the tropics of Cancer and Capricorn.
Yeah.
I think that belongs to the ants for a while. I think that we retreat to frozen areas. Really?
I like how you're ready to give it up for the ants.
Oh, no, I'm just going to say they win full stop. I mean, I don't see how you're going to stop them. They got the numbers. 10 million to one? How many
can I stomp if I start playing, some Michael Flatley river dance music.
Not 10 million.
Do you think you could ever kill 10 million?
In your lifetime?
Ever.
Do you think you could kill 10? Can really?
They're tiny.
No. Okay. Okay.
Beyond brute force. I mean, again, we have gigantic crop dusters that we can just be, dropping whatever.
How many do you think you kill in one? How many, if they're all coalescing on a carpet below you, in how many do you think you could stomp on if they're on your tile floor, if they're all gathered together in mass?
I would say of 10 million, I would say 0.00001.
How many think under a footprint, under one footfall, how many do you think would crush if you stomped down on them?
Well, given when ants are I don't know how on top of each other are they? Because normally they spread out. I would say
one ant layer, just one ant deep. How many are you going to fit into an average male footprint size?
I don't know, maybe 700 tops if you're lucky.
Let's call it 1,000.
Fine, let's call it 1,000, which means it'll only take 1,000 stomps without getting bit or injured or stopped.
Oh, you get bit.
Somebody look up the amount of steps in a Michael Flatley river day.
Michael Flatley is your protagonist, Andrew.
Yeah, finally, the Irish hero.
So you take, if I take 500 strides, I've killed a million.
No, but they've already killed you. You're insane. Okay, look, weight of ant. Doggone it. Or mass of ant? Mass?
There's also
using Wolfram Alpha.
Yeah. There's also how insidious it is, because there are so many times when I've been standing in someone's yard and suddenly, oh, I've been in a fire ant bed for the last three minutes.
Yeah. So somebody in the chat room give me the mass of the average ant times 10,000, because like the biomass of all ants is much, much more than, I mean, you're looking at a foe for each individual player. Now, that doesn't even factor in every time the ants take out a human. They now it's 20 million to one on the next guy.
Oh, yeah.
It's like then they just keep rolling. But you're telling me you're going
to
step
on them? There's no way we're ceding land to ants. We will light the rivers of flame. With chemicals before we seed something to ants.
I think third world.
I'm getting in my truck. I don't have my imaginary truck. I'm like getting a steamroller. I'm taping myself up. Assuming they don't get me right. If you give me a call like right now, ants are going crazy. I'm grabbing everybody in the house. We're wrapping ourselves in plastic wrap. You know.
Well, think about third world countries.
Just start stomping these things.
Third world countries are going to be completely obliterated.
Hey, that's what I'm saying. When I say we lose everything north to south, yeah, agreed. That's exactly what I'm saying. By the way,
not this man.
In mass, it looks like 10 million ants is about 0.71 typical standard human adult masses. So almost the size of your body you're up against. That's how many ants.
That's true. Yeah, that's a number I'd heard. But also understand, like, how many are in this? That's worldwide. How many are in this neighborhood?
Okay, that is true. But again, that's why I'm saying I bet there's a lot more. I mean, Brazil, you think Brazil's going to just stomp their way out of that?
No,
rainforest comes
no,
leaf cutter ants,
away,
man.
I agree. No, Brian, I'm not saying that everybody survived. You're saying
everybody's
gone between here and there.
Understand, you and I are on the same team as far as believing that eventually humans will win.
I don't know whose team you're on.
We both agree that humans will end. I think that there would be a lot more losses, especially if it was a Pearl Harbor surprise attack. I think.
What about the Orkin factory?
I think that those 800 people will definitely live while the city of 8 million around them falls.
And then they're gonna march triumphantly forward with their spray tanks or whatever
and try
to save people.
Again, the question at hand is how bad are the losses before we rebound?
Catastrophic, Brian.
Yeah, I know. So give me a number.
Are you happy now?
Yeah, no, I want you to guess. That's the whole point of this game.
Wait, hold on. The whole point of this was he wanted to guess a death toll?
Yes, that's exactly. Like, how good a strike,
Brian,
will they get in before they go down?
I promise you this. More ants will die than humans.
What by the numbers?
So when?
Okay.
USA, USA.
Yeah, I just don't know where to put a 40,000, a million. I don't know in the fake ant attack. Like, I don't know. I suspect that we are thinking of the most devastating version of it. And should this become a massive issue, that we would have possibly over-the-top, long-term, harmful, solutions that we would deploy because we are scared and angry people.
All right, we need to let's go into picks and change the topic radically away from where we're headed with that. Anybody see any movies they want to talk about?
Man, you know what? This was a crazy week.
Did we all see Ant-Man?
Oh, geez. I can't wait. That happened since last time we did the show, didn't we? Wow. Yeah, you saw Ant-Man too, right?
No, I never go to the movies.
Do you care if we spoil it for you?
You know, I know already a lot about it. With the Marvel movies, I mean, you know how many Marvel comics I read, I watch it and I'm like, well, of course that happened because that's what happened. So go ahead.
Okay, right on. You won't believe it. An unlikely charismatic hero is placed in a situation where he has to take on a villain. What did you guys think?
I liked it. I liked the Ant-Man. You know, it's kind of very interesting because the idea of Ant-Man, I think, very much filled what my expectations were for it. You know, Ant-Man to me is kind of a peripheral character. I think you know, Paul Rudd was great in the role, but you know, a fun little fairly. It takes one big detour out of self-contained during the movie. But by and large, this is about, you know, three people that are trying to hoodwink one person. The global ramifications are kind of hinted at compared to most Marvel movies where it's like, if this man hits this button, the world will split in half. And it was great. It certainly felt like a script that characteristically un-Marvel-like seemed to be a bit disjointed, and it doesn't quite know whether or not it's a Paul Rudd movie or a Michael Douglas movie in terms of where you're focusing on the main character for the first two acts. But the third act, once we get into the heist, I thought was super fun. It had really like some of the more inspired sort of beats for that kind of Marvel visual language stuff that almost, I read a review that made a point that it almost felt Pixar-esque in terms of how they were, especially in the visual beats in the third act. There's just a lot of like, not a lot of wasted moments. Like somebody looks to the left and there's like just a really funny sight gag and those kind of permeate them. So I dug it. I thought it was rad.
Man, I felt it was. I felt like there was an in like. Oftentimes, there'll be movies where you have a fun enough process, and you realize the entire time you've been watching an install screen, and the bar got to like 66%, and then all of a sudden it's like a rubber band snaps, and everything starts going fast. You're like, oh wait, that's why we had the thing so that we could see the. Oh, and that's why we learned about the so and so, so he would. And this one, I felt like. I felt like, for example, during his training phase, it's like, you got to jump through this keyhole to practice. And I was like, oh, this is going to be great. This is going to be like a video game movie where it's like, we're going to learn a bunch of his skills. We're going to see him use. And then it's going to be an orgasmic display of all of them coming together. And instead, we only saw him jump through the keyhole and then we saw him jump through a bullet hole later. And then it's like, you've got to think like an ant to make the ants think or whatever. And it was like, oh, this is going to be a animal companion movie. We're going to learn to fall in love with his favorite ant, Flyboy, and give names to them all. And instead, it's just one ant. And then, you know, if and when that one dies, like, you know, and then plus also is, oh, you know, hopefully we'll be really sad when an ant gets squished. But instead, you know, ants bite dudes and he's like, ah, and the ant's still clearly alive. It was like G.I. Joe when every time a Cobra ship got blown up, you always saw a parachute come out afterwards. You never saw an ant get squished the entire time. I felt like it was almost everything
there's
about
some
this.
Lambs that got
there's some what?
Lambs that certainly did.
Man, which scene is that? I'm blank. Oh, that's right. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, when they miniaturize the lamb. You know, I felt like it was two-thirds of the way towards three different movies, each of which I would have really, really liked. Instead, I got Ant-Man, which it was all right. It was good. I'm glad, you know, I don't want my money back or nothing. And I'm glad it's part of the, you know, overall cinematic universe. I'd rather have Ant-Man than not have Ant-Man.
I like that they put the heist structure onto the story.
Oh, sure,
which I've heard. I haven't seen it. But I'm excited to see that.
And they do, and it is good. It's a good heist. I'll tell you what, though, the superstar of the entire thing one of the things that makes movies really memorable to me is when they do something that I've never seen before, and they do it better than I've ever seen it before. And they're definitely in Ant-Man is a single scene that I'm like, I've never seen that done so well. And it takes place in the 80s, and it's when you have old Agent Carter and young Hank Pym in the room together, perfectly, perfectly executed. You remember, like, we almost got that with Tron Legacy, mm-hmm. with, you know, young Kevin Flynn. But being in the theater, maybe it looks better on Blu-ray or whatever, but being in the theater, it's like...
Fantastic.
It was robot-y face, and it felt very CG weird, very uncanny valley, whereas this absolutely passed the test. Like, nice. All of a sudden, it occurred to me, Like, holy crap. Somebody could make a Michael Douglas movie starring a 40-year-old Michael Douglas today from beginning to end. They could do Fatal Attraction or whatever, and I would never even know that it's not that he's not 40 years old now.
Because that scene is computer age down Michael Douglas, a physical aging up of Haley Atwell for Agent Carter. Then there's bad guy that we're being introduced to and real John Slattery looking like John Slattery as Tony Stark's dad.
Howard Stark.
Old Howard Stark. So it's like you have kind of three different ways, I mean, of these people, and they all look, it looks like an 80s, a scene set in the 80s. Like, it was remarkable.
Yeah, it's like a touring test for the Uncanny Valley just got passed for the first time. You know, wow. It's like I bought it. And if you showed someone that scene in isolation, they would not recognize anything extraordinary about it at all. Like, oh, yeah, no, it's an older woman. It's this younger guy.
Star
yeah.
Chamber? Was this Douglas's? I loved it. I get all of your observations on it, and in the middle of it, I'm kind of going like, well, how do I feel about this, whatever. But like, it was fun. I love Edgar Wright, but I did not want to see Edgar Wright do a Marvel movie. I did not want Edgar Wright to kind of pop a hole in the Marvel universe and do a farce or do something that was just this. How does this fit there? Not to say it wouldn't have been a great movie, but I liked this. I thought, you know, it was very, very comedic. I was worried because I saw a preview at Disneyland a couple months ago that fell flat to me, and it's a lot of people talking in a house, a lot of this. But as Jason pointed out, thank God they used a heist structure. Thank God we got away from the what's it. There was still a what's it, but yeah. It was more of a we need to get the what's it, not stop. You know, you look at the plot of both Avengers movies, Thor the Dark World, which I loved, by the way, but still – how they're all the same thing on paper. And that was the same as like Transformers 2, you know, which was when Avengers came out, I'm like, man, like I saw the same plot in Transformers, in the last Transformers movie, you know, and some of the same creatures, you know. But I like that they did it different. I like the stuff with Michael Pena with his humor and the way that played in. I was glad to see that in the Marvel Universe, they could go a little bit more, you know, tongue in cheek, which reminded me of like, okay, this is like the Marvel comics. Some of them are going to be a bit more goofy than others, you know, yeah. But it just more of kind of has to do with the people around them and the way they act, not so much that the rules are different or the rules are more goofy. And so I thought that it did a very good job.
And I think you make a really good point where it's like the Marvel Cinematic Universe does not need to be a single unified narrative from beginning to end. It needs to be a collaborative patchwork quilt of wildly different stories and archetypes and villains and heroes that somehow, you know, that just, and again, a quilt's a good metaphor because, you know, we're not fooled into thinking that this sheet was all manufactured at once, you know, mm-hmm. or that this blanket was all made at once. Like, this is clearly made of a bunch of wildly different materials on there. Yeah. And I think there's a place for that.
And my test of it is like, could we take a scene out of here and put it into another Marvel movie and you still go, okay, I feel like I'm in the same universe. I'm in a different, you know, I'm in Santa Monica. I'm not in Chicago, you know, or I, you know, this is when people are kind of, I'm with, you know, funnier people instead of dour people or whatever, but does it fit that? And not to say that they might do in Marvel comic movies or Marvel movies, like trailer sequences or maybe two of them. But if they did hypothetically, and one of them might have been from a totally different Marvel movie, but you'd go, yeah, no, this still fits. I think these worlds are connected.
Were you speaking over my head? Were you talking about Fantastic Four there, or
no? Talking about the end credit scene at the end of Ant-Man.
God dog it! I didn't stick around.
You dumbass!
They keep all right. Screw you! Screw all of you! Because you can't train me to stick around till after the credits and then stick a fist up my butt in Avengers 2 and not deliver and then say like, no, dude, we're not doing sticking around till after our credits right. again. And you then turn around and mock me because I didn't stick around for the credits after being trained to not stick around for the credits. I'm done with this BS of being teased about whether or not to stick around for the credits.
If only there was a thing called the internet where you could just look and say,
dude,
hey,
I ain't checking no internet to be like, oh, golly, I'm going to see a movie. Should I stick around for the credits before this? You're going to make an app for that? You're going to make an Apple Watch thing that buzzes?
It looks
like you're watching Ant-Man. You might want to stick around for after the credits. No, that's dumb. I'm done. I'm out. The movie's over. I'm out of there.
So what you're saying is that you participated in the parade of suckers.
Sure. No, you know what? Y'all's the suckers sitting around for
that's
everything.
That's you, old color guard Brushwood, just leading the parade of suckers out of the theater.
No, dude, I'm opting out. The movie ends when the credits start. That's the law.
You're drawing a line in the sand.
That's right. And I'm going to squish.
That's what's happening.
I'm going to squish any ants that come over that line in the sand. I'm taking Adrian Maine's advice. I'm buying a steamroller. I'm going to crush all of them. What's that?
Do you want to know what you missed?
What did I miss?
And there's actually a really fun story to it. It's actually really rad.
Well, let's hear it.
Tell them what the scene was.
So the scene, spoiler alert for anybody who has not seen the movie.
Me. Who didn't. Anyone who, or people who watched the movie but didn't stick around until after the credits.
So it's Cap and Falcon and just completely dropped into it. Bucky is caught in a vice with his metal arm in this gigantic robot vice. It's just like, this, you're completely put in.
We just came into the middle of some other movie.
I think it's actually a scene from Civil War.
It's a scene.
So they're like, hey, should we call Stark? And Captain's like, no, we can't do it right now. We just need to make sure that we get in there without killing him. And Falcon just looks at Cap and says, I know a guy. And then it says Ant-Man will return in Civil War. So that's an actual scene from the dailies of Civil War that they're shooting now, and Kevin Feige saw it and was like, this would be great as a bumper for Ant-Man. And I thought it was like, it was kind of really cool to just do an end little tease thing that wasn't just fanboy.
Did you see the Wasp tease, Brian?
I did see that. Okay. Well, again, I like happened every other time. You know, I was like, oh, good. They did me the courtesy of giving me the little extra giblet at the end instead of making me sit through credits first. Yeah, I'm done. I'm out. If I see a single name, I'm out of there.
All right, Brian, we all understand you left the theater. It's fine. No one's going to make fun of you anymore. But you don't need to unleash your holy jihad on the concept of after trailer stingers.
Look, the stinger trailer was Captain America: Civil War in its entirety.
God, talk about
yeah, they just played the movie.
I don't care. I don't care if it's freaking erotic slash fiction being acted out by the actors afterwards. I ain't gonna stick around for it. I see a single key grip. I'm out of the theater. That's my new law.
Gentlemen, let's just. Running along here, let's say our pick is Ant-Man and stay for the end.
Yeah, no, I agree. Stay, be a better man than me. Stay for the end.
Ants. Weird.
That was great, guys. Hey, so we've started doing something different lately for our patrons to get early. We do a little program called After Things where we just sit around and chit-chat. You want to join us for that as well?
Yeah, if I can take a quick break.
Yeah, no, we usually do. This is usually... Welcome to the biological break portion of the program, yes. Ladies and gentlemen.
Skipped out, but Andrew was unrolling his plan, and I'm like, yes, I'm in. I gotta know
how you're gonna live. I really would read World War A.
Oh, that would be amazing. Absolutely. But I'm glad you mentioned Phase 4, Andrew, because I was wanting to bring it up, but I was like, nah, that's a deep cut.
This show? No.
Yeah, right.
There are no cuts deep enough.
Everybody say hello to Brett. She'll entertain us.
Hi, Brett.
Hello.
How are we
doing? Ants. Wow, I was researching ants while you guys were talking. I'm like, well, there's this many. How would it take? And I'm like, trying to do all scientific research. That's going too fast.
That is the question, is how many are, like, have lethal capacity? Because, like, a sugar ant wouldn't kill you, right? And if that's factoring into the, you know, the big gigantic disparity figure, then, like, that's a little misleading.
Yeah, a little bit. It's not a science fiction author. I'm like, well, what am I going to go kill them with? I'm like, flamethrowers. So I'm like, all these images of just killing all of these ants.
It would be kind of an interesting sociological thing. Like, you know, like town by town to see, like, who lights their town on fire, who poisons the reservoir, you know, so the ants die. Like, that it would be an interesting town by town solution of how you harm yourself to kill the ants.
Yeah, I mean, it would make great little short stories of, you know, everyone becomes ant killers. I automatically thought the birds, you know, Alfred Hitchcock. And yep. It's interesting because you never think, like, you always think zombies or, like with me, I read about lots of different types of weird creatures, but I've never put ants or insects in it. But it's definitely getting in the next book now because something that's just so small, it could be so lethal.
You could almost do a, like, you know, those series that, like, you know, totally replace all the actors every season, like True Detective or Fargo or American Horror Story, where each season is a new ant invasion tale, and we find out how everybody tears themselves apart as the ant tide rises.
Yeah, and they're very intelligent as well, and it's not just like a regular. It's not like a fly. Flies are horrible too. I mean, they just ants. So many ants. Talking about ants so much.
Well, you know, I wonder what would be worse. Would ants or mosquitoes? Because
mosquitoes are already doing harm. They're already causing major problems.
Yeah, but imagine if for whatever reason in Mosquito HQ they figured out that they needed to spread certain diseases to certain populations. I feel like this would be a way bigger. I'm on Team Mosquito in terms of ruining civilization.
Mosquitoes are horrible.
Oh, they're the worst.
They nearly killed two. You know, hey, people think that you write old people on, like, there was really, like, there's like 80-year-olds on the street, and they got bit by mosquitoes, and they got West Nile, and it's like, yeah. The mosquitoes are already doing major harm.
Exactly. They're the killers. They're here already.
Screwed once all ants grow wings. Then we're totally screwed. Then it's like the birds, except for the miniature, and we can't get rid of them.
Oh, my God.
I'm looking at a Hellboy poster signed by Guillermo del Toro.
All right, well, I'm going to take my bathroom break.
And your sister.
Yes, my name's first, though. Britt sounds better first.
So, all right, you guys... On. Hey, wait, it was Britt, right?
Yeah, I'm Britt.
All right, Britt, are you on team Justin and Andrew, insane person, like, oh, who cares? We'll lose a few people, but we'll destroy the ants instantly because humanity's that awesome. Or are you on team Brian and, I don't know, if you're on my team, Jason?
Oh, I'm on your team.
Okay, we're going to get massive casualties.
Oh, yeah. We're going down.
I think we're just going to lose a few people, but we'll figure it out.
You're crazy. No. I know. The over-under is 50% of humanity, is what I say. Oh, I think we lose 50% of humanity.
I think that could happen. I think that's a realistic number.
Oh, God, okay. We agree the whole time.
I just, when you were like, when you're gone, you're gone.
We can have Britt on for after things if you like.
I want to do, we'll have her sister on like a whole show and do that.
Okay.
They do very interesting stuff. Both writers, science fiction writers, they teach writing courses and stuff.
Oh, cool.
I'm learning a lot.
Awesome.
So,
I'm just leaf cutter ants, guys. Leaf cutter ants.
Well, that's the thing is, I figured there's I figure all of Africa up to the desert is lost, and then they have a chance.
I'm thinking South Africa would be okay. Like Cape Town and stuff like that, maybe.
You think? You mean if they're super smart about their civil defense,
but everything else,
yeah,
like Central Congo, Uganda, Rwanda,
where you already have problems of distribution of resources and stuff,
wrecked.
Yeah.
Do we have a topic for after things?
Do you know what? I actually do. We'll mark it right now. I'm sure Neshcom's already on it, 75 minutes in. You want to kick us off or you want me to start us off?
Go for it. You start.
Hey, gang. Welcome to After Things. We got Andrew Main. We got Jason Murphy. We got Justin Robert Young. And I kind of got to see a bit of a preview. I almost wish Bonnie was here with us, because listening in on a 30-minute conversation between Jason Murphy and Bonnie Brushwood gave me a really good idea for a topic on where to start. Bonnie, many people know if you follow @InvisibleWife on Twitter, has been working on a children's book. You know, she's going to illustrate it and write it. And, you know, like many children's books, it's not exactly the most gripping of tales, but it's really fun and a neat idea that she's working on. And she's wondering what the best way, you know, she's not doing it because she wants a giant payday. She's doing it because there's something in here. Wait, what are you doing?
There's significant wincing.
Wait, what do you mean? Oh, just because.
It's not the most gripping of tales, but you know.
Here's the thing. When it's 10 pages long and you only get one sentence a page, there's only so many soul-crushing ideas giving tree aside.
For sale. Yeah. Baby shoes, never worn.
Jace, exactly what I was thinking.
Fair enough.
Imaginary Hemingway quote.
Fair enough.
Yeah, smash cut to Shel Silverstein, double middle fingers.
Granted, you guys are right and I'm wrong.
Where does the sidewalk end, bro?
totally fine. But what was interesting was Bonnie talking about her plan of how she plans to release it and, how that might open up an opportunity for publishing. And then Jason was talking about, you know, because you've written on the size scale, a very different, you've written a full narrative book and how you've gotten conflicting advice at how to go about publishing.
Yeah.
And so we've got Bonnie going through her experience and she knows what she wants to do. We've got Andrew who's been through the process. I'm not announcing, but you guys know the next Scam School book comes out in like 3 weeks. Scam School book 2, my second published book, comes out. It might be neat for us to have a discussion now about the different ways to go about it.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Do you want to share kind of your conflict about two different paths?
I mean, I've been going back and forth with this for a while because I would have periods throughout my entire life where I would write prose, you know, write short stories or novels and so forth. You know, it's far back when I was a kid and writing, I'm Ghostbusters 3 or whatever. The novel, the 13-page novel. I would give up because it was never – the market is so staggeringly different now.
What made you give it up to begin with? Because when we first met, you had written a whole novel kind of based loosely on the characters you developed.
A fantasy novel. Yeah. Yeah. And I got some feedback on it. I wasn't sure what to do with it. The feedback was correct. Some of it was really good. Some of it was really bad, you know.
Right.
And I just said, screenplays are easier. And so I transitioned into that, it's kind of true in some ways, but in other ways, it's completely wrong.
Right.
But I got back into it recently just because I realized, I really enjoy this. I really enjoy doing it. And so I've been talking to, should I?
You don't need a name. Give him a different name.
Okay. I've been talking to a friend.
A friend of ours who is
everybody's going to know who it is.
Who is a successful novelist.
Yeah.
And who had some advice that differed from my advice, right?
And his advice was, you write some short stories and you try to get them published. And if they don't get published, it's because they're not good enough. So you keep working on them until they are good enough. And then you write a novel. Okay, you wrote this one novel. Now write another one. And I'm still editing that first one, but he's like, now write another one. Okay. And then another one. And then once you're good enough, you'll be able to get it in front of the right people. You build up some steam and some cachet from having these published in, anthologies or chapbooks or, magazines or what have you, or even on websites. And once you get those published, then you'll build up enough steam and people will show interest and they'll start reaching out to you and you'll know people that you can pitch to and so forth. Very much the traditional method.
Sure.
Right?
Sure.
Very fantastic advice for 1985.
Exactly. It's the traditional ladder structure, right?
And then I have Brian telling me, no, put your book out on the internet right now. Use your phone. Upload it. Upload it right now and make it for free. And then... you just read it to people over the internet or draw pictures about it, put it on Instagram, and people will buy them, you know.
So, actually, it's great that Britt's here. Britt and her sister Brianna have written a number of books. They started self-published originally, right? The Strand Prophecy was the first one?
Mm-hmm.
And, there is no right path. There's the path that works for you. I'd written stuff years ago that I thought sucked because it did. And then finally, when I wrote like a novel, you know, that I thought, okay, I wrote a novella, said Justin read it, said, no, this doesn't suck. I'm like, okay, good. Publish. Other people said, you know what? This doesn't suck. And my Amazon reviews were 4 stars, 5 stars. So average of 4.5 stars, you know, 60 reviews. I'm like, this is good. Wrote a novel, Public Enemy Zero. Wasn't sure if it sucked or not. Justin said, no, this does not suck. I'm like, okay, maybe we'll put this out there. We put the novel out there. Boom, 4 stars, 5 stars, 4.5 stars.
Just self-publishing to Amazon.
Self-published to Amazon. Yeah, next thing you know, 99 cents. Movie deals, yeah. Literary agents.
Right.
Parties with kangaroos.
So
airplanes, swimming pools.
Britt will tell you her experience.
Well,
with her
I think you have a different. Well,
wow, that was amazing.
Oh my God, you're good.
I'm not asking about it. Okay, I'm just
no, lean in. Like, good.
Okay, I'm gonna lean in. Okay, I think it depends. I mean, Dan Drew had a different. He already had another career before he wrote. I mean, if you're not known for anything yet and you have an invisible online presence, it's going to be a little bit more difficult for you. So it's more than just being an author. It's also about having a full marketing plan. So it's almost like you have to balance two different careers or two different paths at once. So the first thing you need to do is finish your manuscript, which I think is the most difficult part because you always think it's going to suck no matter how far you get. And you can rewrite it 15, 20 times, you're always going to think it's going to suck. So what you need to do is have trusted readers that you really, you know, actually, you know.
It's the Winter Twins. They're staples at many conventions and stuff talking about this. Go ahead.
So. That you actually trust and get the opinion, but you can't listen to the inner voice in your head that's going to say you suck because it's always going to say that.
Well, yeah. I feel like if that voice is not saying that you suck, then you're not getting any better.
Right.
Yeah. I think you're not getting any better. What you really need to, I mean, I wrote short stories that I just put in a drawer that I opened up just a few weeks back and went, oh my God, this is amazing. I'm going to put it out this year. It just takes time to overcome yourself because you're the biggest critic.
Well, so here's an interesting question because part of the reason, you know, Andrew has a background as a magician, which I would imagine to a number of people who've known you for your you know, however many illusion books that you had previously written to see you suddenly. Not suddenly, but to try to pivot and see you as a science fiction author, maybe raise some eyebrows, and then, you know, until they read it, and then they're like, oh, wait, no, also, he's a brilliant, brilliant science fiction author. You know, Jason, as far as his online presence, Britt, you know, you have an extreme, I would say among the strongest, most passionate, most inside jokey, most dedicated of online followings for his comedy video game playthrough show of Rage Select. And the question is, you know, does all of that not count because the book he's writing is a horror book? Is it the kind of thing that people are, is it off brand enough for him to put it out there? That
No, you're absolutely right. That's something I was very concerned about is, and you mentioned that, well, you're not building fans of a certain thing that you're saying. You're building a community of people that you virtually hang out with where, you know, your idea was that you can put anything out there and the people will show some interest in it at first, anyway, unless you burn them with terrible quality or whatever.
But, sure.
But yeah, it's like, am I being, you know, as a guy who's known for making dick jokes over video games, if I release this weird horror novel,
you know? Totally in brand for you. It's not like you're all of a sudden going to be doing cappuccino recipes and cat quilts.
Right.
The people who buy horror novels, there's a huge overlap. I started with sci-fi because we did Weird Things, and most of our Weird Things listeners read sci-fi.
Yeah.
So I said, that's going to be an overlap. Once I had an audience for sci-fi, I said, you know what? I'm going to write thrillers and mystery. I'm going to go a bit outside. And I would say that I lost a lot of Weird Things listeners because it's you know, like, what? Or no, robots or aliens. And so the ones that were already reading that kind of stuff loved it and dug it, but I didn't. But I had to go find a whole new audience. But
yeah.
I had enough, like a bunch of little ants that we all kind of climbed over the chasm to. I think it's totally in brand for you. I think if other people, you know, and it's hard to know if you have something that sucks, your friends won't tell you. And that's another thing to know, like, okay, am I going to be writing a much better thing 2 years from now or 3 years from now? And sometimes when people give me advice, I'm always trying to read between the lines because are they being diplomatic? Are they what? But once you, if you think it's good enough, put it out there. You know, and if you put it out there for like a couple months and it gets horrible reviews, pull it back. You know, and that may not be the best strategic way from somebody trying to go for a publishing contract. But if you want to write and find an audience, it's the most expedient way.
Well,
here's the other thing is I think an online audience is a lot more forgiving and self-selecting and resistant to whatever too clever by half machinations that I think we want to overlay on it. And whenever you get too fine on, like, well, is this exactly in the quadrant that I want to activate? Or, you know, just do it and put it out there. And then really the biggest question is how hard you market it to your existing fan base, you know, beyond.
In which way, you know, sorry, I'm going to talk until the Skype, there you go, the Skype fixed it. Imagine the internet. Here's the way I picture it is imagine the internet is a campfire and we're all taking turns telling stories and you are known for a particular brand of story. We'll give you a one shot. You know, you're like, hey, guys, mind if I tell a scary story instead of dick jokes this time? And it's like, yeah, we'll listen to it. But whether or not we listen next time, whether or not we say yes next time, will depend on how good you are at telling scary stories instead of dick jokes, right? At some point, the work itself begins to stand on its own.
I think that there's been a lot of creators that they've done something that's been kind of off-brand, and I've tried it, and I haven't liked it, and I still love everything that they do, and will go for the next side project because, you know, that just wasn't my speed.
I'm a big fan of Joe Lansdale. He wrote Bubba Hotep.
Oh yeah.
And he's known for this like mojo horror, this weird East Texas kind of, almost like a bunch of Evil Dead 2 type stuff where it's kind of filthy and crazy and horrific. But he's got a show coming out on Showtime soon, based on his East Texas noir stuff. And I had always read him for his horror stuff. And then I said, well, let me pick up one of these Happen Leonard books. And it's going to be on, it's a series, going to be on Showtime. I said, let me pick up one of these Happen Leonard books. And I was like, oh, this is not horrific at all, but this is where he really shines. So I don't know. Maybe I'm answering my own question with that, but.
Do you have an email list? Do you have like an email list of like, you know, people who are. Do a test run, like say, hey, I wrote this thing. I want to send it out to my fans.
Okay.
You know?
Well, and here's the thing. You can even couch it in a way where there is no fail. You can start announcing to the world today that in 60 days, you're going to do, Project J, which is your attempt to see, you know, you're going to release a horror novel in 60 days, but it's only going to be to people to sign up at the email list. That's how you kind of identify your hardest of the hardcore fans, the people who are willing to go on the ride for anything. You get their email list, you build that, and then you release it. You're like, hey, I'm going to give it to you guys early since you're all cool, rad bros, and then I'm going to release it on Amazon, you know, for full price or 99 cents, however you want to go about doing it. But then you have framed the entire thing as an experiment. And once you frame anything as an experiment, there literally is no way to fail because all your experiments do not fail. What they do is experiments yield
results.
They yield valuable intel.
Britney's going to explode if she does not talk.
Release your first three chapters.
Well, okay. Here's my question to that, Britt, because we talked about that. And you know, like Scott Sigler, what he's doing the same thing with his current book. He's releasing it chapter by chapter as an audiobook. But if somebody is caught up in it and they're like, no, I want this right now, there's a button to press that gets you the full book instantly.
Do pre-orders. So what I did, because I write sci-fi superhero, my first series is sci-fi superhero. My next series is sci-fi romance, far future, very different. So what I did, and my fans were getting, you know, they're getting angry. They're like, where's the next book? I'm like, I'm writing something different. So what I did is I released the first three chapters and I sold it and I said, okay. So it's $5 and this is hardcover, but for online, you can do it for free. This is what I did for the cons. I said, here's $5, you get the hardcover, only printed in 300 of them. You get it signed and you become a first reader, which basically means you're going to get the ARC as soon as it comes out on ebook and tell me what you think. So that just blew up and all of us got really excited. Now, what I do if I were you is send out the first three chapters via your email list, see what the response is. Well, and there's nothing that's going to go wrong. I mean, you already have a fan base, but because you're writing in a different genre, you're going to get part of that fan base that goes with you, part of who's not interested, but you're going to get just more people that see what your brand is.
Well, is the end goal a publishing deal? Do you want that?
Are you asking yourself?
I'm just asking, you know, I don't know. I'm asking everyone.
There's a spectrum. I will say on my end that the only reason I took a publishing deal is because it would yield about the same results monetarily as self-publishing. It would require I would essentially be recruiting a team of other people to do the tedium that I don't feel like doing, and you get the cachet, whatever that's worth, of being a, right. a real published thing, which right. to me doesn't matter a lot. But again, to other people, but, especially in a world where, you know, I'm trying to, at the time I was trying to sell Hacking the System yeah. with you, and it's like, well, it matters. We'll call it, you know, so I probably, out of everyone here, value a traditional well, publishing deal the least.
I go to Barnes
maybe,
and Noble.
Maybe don't. Maybe I value more less than you, Brian.
Oh, wow. Really?
I go to Barnes and Noble, and you know that, like, what, 2% of the people on the shelves at Barnes and Noble make a living off of their books, and the yeah. rest of them teach or whatever?
My,
you know,
my goal was never traditional publishing. That was never my goal. My yeah. goal was get in front of as many people as I possibly can. Yeah. And, you know, my self-publishing, you know, I've sold 250,000 books self-published, you know, and as going with a publisher, I said, well, this, let me take a book that I already released and did great with self-published. I'll let a publisher buy it. And now what I'll do is, you know, I'll get into airports, I'll get into other places and do that. And where they want to work with me, that'll be great. Where that publishing world doesn't want to work with me, fine. Working with a literary agent, though, is great, because then it's, I have a TV deal with a major studio and producer right now, which I won't name or say what title it is, but that was because my literary agent went out to Hollywood and knocked on doors and said, you got to read this, you got to read this. And several people came back and said, we want this. And then that happened. So there are pros and cons to it. But your success as a writer isn't decided if somebody in New York says, we're going to print this. Your success yeah. as a writer is dependent upon, one, you liking it, and at least one other human being going, man, Jason Murphy told me a great story and I enjoyed that. How you get from there to there doesn't matter.
Yeah, because it doesn't, you know, I look at all the people that, let's just from a financial perspective, you know, you've got so few of the people that you see on the shelves of the biggest book retailer in the world, or in the country anyway, Barnes & Noble. Most of them aren't making enough money off of advances and royalties.
And an even smaller percentage on Amazon ebook are making money, though. So, you know.
There's that, yeah. But then you read, and these are always the exceptions, I know, but you read about, oh, there's this guy in Great Britain. He turns out, you know, three books a year, and he's making $450,000. But that's a drastic anomaly.
That's
right?
The exception, and that's an even smaller percentage than the people who are making a success in the publishing realm. That what you want is you have to have a, you know, if the goal, if you're telling me, well, how do I make the most money? Well, you go to a genre where people buy a lot of books and you write for that genre sure. and you sell your soul and you do that.
Yeah.
If your goal is to write what you want to love and share it with an audience you want and then try to figure out on how to capitalize it the yeah. best you can, you know, look what she and her sister do. Look what they do. They connect with fans. They go out there and they get to do that. If a publishing opportunity comes up and it makes sense, you do it, but
that's I think a very key distinction is that to me the publishing deal is a byproduct of the machine that you already have a lot of the materials for and you just need to put in practice. Yes. That if you have a fan base that reacts well, that reviews well, that you know has enough momentum to kind of chart you sales wise, that puts everything closer to you. You know, it gives you a better, a more interesting publishing options. But I bet you Brittany would have something smarter than me to say.
Well, it seems like the publishing.
I'm
gonna let you finish. No, it just seems like the publishing deal serves as a, at this point anyway, serves as a promotion almost to whatever else you're working on. But I'm sorry, Britt, go ahead.
It really doesn't matter if you have a publishing deal or not. You're still going to have to do a lot of work. I mean, what people think is there's just like, well, if I get a publisher, then I'm made.
Right.
No, they just have your rights and they can shelf you. That means you're on the Barnes & Noble shelf on, you know, under W on the very bottom or whatever it is, unless you have something really special and they buy the space for you to be in front. But then they don't have enough money to do the big tours like they used to. And if you are, you're not everyone is a Christopher Paolini.
And Kevin Anderson does cons now. He doesn't do the book stops.
WordFire Press. He started his own publishing company and started doing all the cons. They pay for him to go out. He brings his authors out. Regardless, you have to be everything.
Yeah.
And an author isn't just writing anymore. It has evolved into a multifaceted career that takes up a lot of time. Now, if you need to make a living, I wouldn't suggest trying to be an author as your main thing. I'd do something else. I mean, and because you already have an audience, you're set. I mean, really, you are set. You already have the initial audience. It's not like you're just going to come, oh, I want to write a book, and I do programming. But if for people that, you know, just do programming, do something else and want to write, I was just reading John Locke's book. John Locke did a great way of online promotion and marketing himself.
He was the first ebook author to like sell like a million. And what he was really smart was he identified people who were fellow fans of Penn State football prior to some crisis there. and that was sort of the core fan base. There were people who were fans of the program and all that. And that's where he was the nucleus of his fan base.
You know, my big fan base on Twitter, which is interesting because I've done I did school tours. So I was in front of like 200,000 students. I lost track and I got sponsored by Cisco. So I went international, but just that didn't transfer to Twitter for some reason.
I'm sorry. Keep going. Go ahead.
Yeah. My Twitter fan base is just writers, aspiring writers.
Oh, really?
Yes, that's it. I don't know why. They just wanted anything I write about writing, they freak out. I'm like, what? My Facebook is the con people. It's different. You have to identify where your fans are at and the market to. But my ebooks are all sold through like Twitter, and that's where the ebooks come from. And all the hard, like the actual books that are off my website are from Facebook.
Tell me this, Jason. You know the nature of the book you wrote. Mm-hmm. Would it be appropriate, a male voice to read the book?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. So, now you're in the perfect position because you have a rich baritone voice. You have acting chops. You have a passing familiarity with how podcasting works. I mean,
I've been on a few.
There's really no reason that you can't, you know, today take your best microphone and start reading.
Sure. I actually have gotten the hardware to get set up to do that, to start parsing it out. I just want to do another pass at the edit before I start getting it out there.
We took the page right out of Scott Sigler's book, and we had Justin did, you know, first it was the Grendel Shadow. Justin did the voice, did the narration of that, and that was a great way to cater to our existing podcast audience and get them hooked in there. And then I foolishly started writing books in the first-person point of view of a woman.
And keep in mind also, here's the thing, is there's a propensity among, I think, a lot of creative types to believe that they need to save their best stuff for later when it really counts. But the truth is, you get to recycle and reuse stuff to the celebration of everyone. And we're experiencing that right now with Scam School. Scam School, when we launched Scam School, they're like, well, how many ideas do you have? And I was like, well, 50 off the top of my head. And what I meant was I literally only have 50 ideas for Scam School. And then, here we are 400 episodes later. And we're still doing new material, but now we have this giant back catalog that nobody's ever going to go back and visit. You know, nobody's going to sit through a Netflix ad in which I'm talking about, sign up and we'll send you DVDs or whatever.
Yeah.
So we launched Scam School Remix, and the Scam School Remix is number one, being more, I will make the prediction that 2 years from now, more people will have seen the Scam School Remix episodes of all the episodes we've done than the original episodes.
Yeah.
And that's a case where we put everything out 100% the first time, and then we get to put everything out a second time and double dip, and it will be more successful the second time because the platform is bigger. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So it's like if there's something in you, if there's a story you have, put it out. I mean, how many times, Andrew, out of all the books you've done, and there have been multiple versions of releases, which has been released in the most different formats? Would it be Angel Killer? Because I remember first you released it as a 99-cent ebook, and then you changed the cover and released it as
so
a 99-cent.
There was my self-published version of Angel Killer, and then I changed the cover of that, and then sales picked up.
Right.
Then there was the HarperCollins version of it, and then ebook, and their version print and their ebook. There is a Thai version of Angel Killer. There's a Danish version of Angel Killer. There's the audiobook version of Angel Killer. There is coming, we just released in the UK with Faber, the Faber edition of Angel Killer. And then there's the Anyhow, point is, Angel Killer's had a lot of different versions.
So I guess my point is that Andrew could have had that short circuit moment that I think most artists have of should I or shouldn't I release or should I wait? And the answer, you know, my answer is never to wait. My answer is take the thing in front. I mean, as long as you don't sign a piece of paper that prevents you from dipping into this again, then
That's one of the things that I was kind of grappling with is that If I'm going to release one book, and this is really, you know, kind of secondary or tertiary on the concerns of how you release something, but if I'm going to release one book on Amazon, should I have another in the chamber?
No, Jason, you know, how long ago did you write this book?
Finished the first draft in May.
Okay, that's not, you can overthink this thing. Yeah. You can overthink this stuff and, well, should I do this? I get into that with, like, strategically, I've written a hell of a lot more than you people see me release. You know, I've probably written now 20 novels, and, you know, most of them will never see the light of day. And I overthink stuff. Have you got good feedback on it? If the answer is yes, if you've got good feedback on it, then release. Her suggestion, put a few chapters out there, see the response to that. That's a great way to dip your toes into the water.
Yeah.
And then you might think, like, oh, you know what? That's good, but let me go back and just tweak these other things because of that response. Or, nope, they're waiting for it. Put it out there. Put out a book. You know, mm-hmm. business plans, all these other sorts of things, and how you're going to game it and all this other stuff. You can spend the rest of your life trying to figure that out. Yeah. Find an audience.
Well, and that's the thing, is you know you have an audience, you know an audience, you know how to talk to them, you know how they respond to stuff. And like, that element will always be your greatest ally.
Yeah.
Like, from you doing it versus, you know, you doing it without the already established audience. The more you can get them excited about it, the better off you're going to be. And you already know that. That's already – the answer was inside you the whole time.
The fifth element is love.
It's never done, only finished.
You know? Yeah.
It's never done. Yeah. I mean, with me, I can go back in my first book and I go crazy over it. And this and this and this and I can't do this.
You were like 9 when you wrote it, though.
I was 12, but actually, the things that actually get me angry over the subplots.
Look at Stephen King's.
Like Gene Hackman in The Royal Tenenbaums. play, you know, well.
I mean, look at Stephen King, who goes back and decides, like,
he released two novels while we were sitting here talking.
I believe it, right? But in
Aliens.
In very different ways, does he, you know, he handled The Stand. He's like, I want to do it again 16 years later and make it pretty much a totally different novel.
And The Gunslinger.
But The Gunslinger was a very different thing where he was like, I just want to nudge just these few things. I really regret these 72 sentences that I wrote wrong. Just going to fix those and I'm done. You know, mm-hmm. It's never done. I mean, I that's a great way to put it. It's never done. I wouldn't even say it's never done as finished, because finished implies that you're not supposed to touch it again. I'd say it's never done. It's published. Like you pressed, it's now out there. And then, you know, that don't mean you can't come back and fix it.
People keep asking me, they're like, did you finish your novel? I said, well, I got to the end.
Yes. That's, you know? that's all there is.
Yeah. And rewriting can go on forever. And that's a whole different.
Yes, we can have this, pick up this conversation again. I have a feeling I'll be back here and we can have Britt here and maybe pull Bree in or what. It just cross your eyes when you look at her and it's the same as having the twins. gentlemen, any recommendations or any suggestions? I guess the John Locke book that she mentioned is really worth checking out. And Neshcom has the link to that. We'll put that up there. And it's a very aggressive way to find an audience in this environment.
You know what? I have a recommendation, and it's not Name of the Devil, although that's a great book. And
well, we're done here, then, guys. Everybody, it's been after.
No, if on this topic, I would say Stephen King's On Writing is an extraordinary book on the craft, and I highly recommend it to get inside the mind of someone who was so successful. And you even made that joke about the mangler earlier.
Yeah.
Which, yeah, it's astonishing.
So my pick is our mutual friend Brett lent this to me, and I finally got around to reading it, but it's the trade paperback for Sex Criminals by Matt Fraction.
I'm a Brimper.
Oh my God, dude, this book. So basically the conceit is that a girl realizes in her sexual awakening that every time she orgasms, time stands still. And so
not figuratively, not figuratively, literally,
literally.
Time stands still.
Like, it's a magic power, right? She then goes her whole life until like her mid-20s when she has a one-night stand and for the first time ever after sex, they are both frozen in time and can talk to each other, and it's revealed that this guy has also had this power.
Oh, I didn't get to that part. I read the beginning of it. That's great.
It's fantastic.
So I just got kind of that pitch, and I wasn't really familiar with Matt Fraction's writing before, so I didn't really know. I mean, I knew he was thought of as a really good writer, but I didn't experience it. And I was kind of like left cold, sort of. It felt like kind of a gimmick, you know. But reading it, it is exceptional. It's really, really, really well written, and it's amazing how much tying in all the pathos that goes along with, you know, what is effectively a sexual kind of discovery, you know, emotions, feelings kind of element with this sort of sci-fi premise that immediately, like within the first two issues, you kind of get into this like sort of weird multi-dimensional Grant Morrison weirdness that kind of goes along with it. But
getting weirder. Yeah, it's funny and filthy and sweet and bizarre.
It's that mixture of from what I read in the first, you know, what I assume was the first issue or so of the darkness. The fact, you know, it reminded me of Lock and Key with a very, very dark beginning and yet fascinating opportunities and adventures that lay ahead.
And it's very honest. And really, I don't know if you've read this, Justin, but the best thing about it, even better than the comic itself, is the letters section.
Oh, I don't know if they have the letter section in the trade paperback.
Yeah, the artist and the writer took a lot of stuff from the letter section, and they released a book of sex tips called Just the Tips.
No kidding.
Oh, really?
Because everyone took this as an opportunity for them to talk about how they achieve standing still of time.
Yeah. It is funniest damn book I have read in a long time, because it's full of horrible sex tips. Just awful, incorrect stuff.
Also, Chip Zdarsky, who is the artist on it, if you just Google his name, he did a thing a while ago where he just made friends with the person running the Applebee's Facebook in his town.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
So whenever he would never be making fun of him. It would always just be like, hey, Sizzlers, like, come on in for skillet steaks at Applebee's tonight. And he would just make a comment. He would just,
like,
always,
I think
nobody
I will.
Would comment on it. He would just leave a comment saying, I had a steak once. My grandpa cooked it. It was a fun memory.
Yeah.
And like just engage with the brand. It's really, really fun.
I actually met Chip Zdarsky about a year and a half ago at a Comic-Con. And my wife commissioned a sketch from him. And she said, you know, you've been doing this all day. Just do whatever you like. And he said, okay. And so he drew a Batman made out of penises. And Batman sitting there's good times with wangs, you know. Thanks, Chip.
Sex Criminals is my pick. And while we're on the subject of respecting your fans and making sure that you let them know in the proper way of your brand new projects, get ready for me to totally disregard all of that, because I got a Kickstarter launching on Friday. And I'm going to shove it down your throat.
Awesome. What's it for? Can you tell us yet?
Yeah. Hold on. Wait a minute.
I think we can prime it for him. Hey, man, you know what's about to happen? People are about to start shouting why they should be the president.
Yeah.
I guess it's already happening.
It is.
And you know what would be great? That seems like a really good subject, ripe for parody, and maybe making a hilarious, fun party game that you could play with cards that's themed around that.
Yes.
If only some... Wait a minute.
Yes.
What is this? Justin Robert Young is holding up a pack of cards that says The Contender. What does that mean?
Well, Brian, I'm glad you asked. The Contender is a game of political debate. I'll show you guys some of the cards here.
Somehow I'm thinking this is going to get weird.
A little bit.
So you get your topic card. So this one is terrorism.
Okay.
And it has like a debate-style question. And then everybody has a hand of five cards that, not unlike Apples to Apples or Cards Against Humanity, you have to respond to it. Except going around the table, you are all political candidates debating each other, and you have to put together the best argument you can. So can we get some
examples?
Yeah, out of those five cards, throw together the best argument you can against terrorism.
Okay, so yeah, terrorism. So the candidate, since the attacks on this nation, a majority of Americans say they expect we will be hit again next year. What can you say to reassure America that the world is not a cold place with death as its only constant? So I could say, if I wanted to put all three of them together, I could.
And by the way, there's a tactical advantage to maybe holding some of your arguments back because you know they'll do better mm-hmm. in another question.
So I could put together, at first, this is one problem we can't solve with space lasers.
That's true. That's true.
And then I could let it go around, and then it would come back to me. And when somebody made a comment, I'd snipe back, oh, great, another opinion. And then maybe just sort of bring it on home for my final play with a good old-fashioned, you're a racist. all of the quotes are actual summarizations of actual quotes that have been said by presidential candidates.
Holy crap. You got to be kidding me.
I did not. Justin, we played this game when we were shooting the video. I never realized. I thought they were just random example, peripherally related things. I didn't realize that they were distilled actual quotes.
Yeah, they're actual. We have, man, I watched a lot of debates.
I want to play this. This sounds great.
Oh my God! You will be able to by backing the Kickstarter this Friday.
Awesome!
So yeah, no, it's something I'm really, really proud of. The design on it, I am really, really thrilled about. Right. We worked with a bunch of friends of ours at a company called Guts and Glory. They are amazing, and Brian's in the Kickstarter video, so
briefly,
you'll be able
briefly,
to see
yeah.
Brian and his not yet recovered wheeze.
Laughs
hysterically.
Sorry. Can we get a possibly if you know once this is successful, maybe a second Kickstarter round to have the we have been invaded by ants expansion
version of
pack.
The contender. Well, yeah,
that's one of the expansions I want to do. Is just is more of the topic cards, but make them. There's always like some crisis that's very of the moment in political campaigns. That like you watch back at old debates and it's like we've all been captivated by the Brownstown fire, like, and it's like I don't even remember the Brownstown fire, like, you know, but it was a big thing in the moment. And so I want to do a bunch of sci-fi.
Oh, like a science fiction. Nice. Okay, so here's the thing, Justin. I think I've been fairly present during the entire creation and playtesting, and as you've shared it both in front of and behind the scenes. I am astonished that this whole time I didn't realize that all of the plays came from actual quotes from debates. I feel like maybe that aspect should really be goosed because that's astonishing.
Here's the problem with it though is and it was us trying to figure out where we wanted to dial the game to. You know, if we make a really big deal about the fact that they are real quotes,
that makes it sound like a more boring game.
A, it's a more boring game, and B, it feels more like, all right, if you don't care, if you don't go to, you know, the Washington Post or Politico every day, you'll never want to play this.
But I hear you, but I think it's a great angle, though, because if you want to get the people at the Washington Post or Politico to pick up your game and talk about it, the fact you've created this really crazy game on crazy things that were actually said in debates is a great point.
I mean, I wonder if the pitch shouldn't be exactly the same as it is, and then just the last line is dot, dot, dot. By the way, all of these outrageous quotes come from actual, like that's the mic drop at the end is plays are from real debates.
Like make no mistake, that is not something that we don't put in there. Like that is okay. That is definitely an element of the sell. It's just not like the lead thing. Because you realize very quick when you're trying to explain a card game you invented, you know, to people, like you got to get your pitch down to like just the facts. And it's like this, like the real quote thing is definitely a fun little accoutrement to it, but it's not the mechanics. And that's always like, otherwise, if you don't spend all your time talking about the mechanics, then people are like, so what?
You don't want it to be Cones of Dunshire.
What is Cones of Dunshire?
It's, if you've ever seen Parks and Rec.
Oh, no. I've seen a couple episodes. Yeah. No, yeah.
But yeah, no. And listen, the Trump Cards expansion is currently
and trust me, the Trump Cards, I'm almost certain, will be Trump Cards in this game.
The deck is going to be like this high already.
Man. No, I mean, I'm thinking because a lot of them we actually have. some of them are actual are interpretations of the quotes, and others we just use the literal quotes because they're so ridiculous, including Al Gore's sigh. We have an Al Gore sigh card.
Have you guys considered from a publicity angle maybe shipping out? I mean, once if only you were to get funded on this Kickstarter and you have them in hand, it seems to me like it would be a great PR move to send copies to all of the current candidates.
Funny enough, Brian, we are going to send copies to all of the candidates with a note that they have to give it back when they quit the race.
Amazing.
Gentlemen, let's round where everybody can find everybody. Brian is at Shwood on the Twitter.
Yep. Forget all that. I'm really excited about Facebook. I've neglected the Facebook side of things. I'm ready to jump in. Facebook.com/Shwood. We're gonna start releasing exclusive video content over at Facebook.com/Shwood. So
and then pain to make sure that it reaches your full audience. That's great.
Yeah.
Britt and Bree, Winner, you can go to
Winner Twins at Winner Twins on Twitter and on Facebook.
Ryan Murphy, otherwise known as Jason Murphy, otherwise known as Captain Murphy, is Brian's Captain Murphy on Twitter?
At Captain Murphy, yes. That's the best place to find me. That's the place where I'm most likely to respond.
And when are you releasing your book?
I'm going to do another pass. This is only like the second pass on the rewrite. And within the next 60 days, guaranteed.
Right on.
I'm saying it right now.
Wait, hold on. You're saying if we don't have, at the very least, a release date within 60 days, we have permission on this show to call and yell at you.
Yes, absolutely. I'm doing it. Right, yes.
Justin, where would we find the contender?
Contender on Facebook at, or just search for Contender Game. If you are at on the Twitter, it's Contender Game. Instagram, Contender Game. And, man, I think this is actually live. Let me double check. But the website that I think links us to... Yeah, thecontender.us is the website. And that will link you to the Kickstarter as soon as that is live.
How soon do those fulfill when you back the Kickstarter to get a copy of that?
You are going to be able to get a PDF of print and plays for the beta deck that we've sent around almost immediately.
Right away. Okay, because once a month, because I'm on Raid Select, where we make dick jokes about video games. Once a month we have the Rage Cast, which is a live video one, and we've started doing like Cards Against Humanity and stuff like that. Would you like for us to play the Contender? Would that be okay? Because I think that would be a great time.
No.
Be able to pick out.
No.
Well, a lot of people would not want the stink of Raid Select on them. So
we will be able to get you a copy of the game. We'll do a little a special print run.
Okay. Yeah, that would be awesome. I think it'd be a great time.
So go ahead and check it out. But that launches Friday. And if you will be at Nerdtacular, we will have special edition campaign buttons for anybody that shows a confirmed screen that you have backed us.
That's great.
Dude, the website looks amazing.
It
Holy
does.
Cow.
Yeah, that's because we actually worked with professionals as opposed to just trying to do it our goddamn selves. And like, man, it makes this look so much better.
So good.
Gentlemen, Britt, it's been after.
Darn straight, it's been after. It's the afterest most show of all time. All right, let me save this. Do we have a title?
The Contender.
Jason Murphy is. Oh, believe you me, we will have more.
Don't spend it now. Don't spend it now.
Jason Murphy's book release party.
Wait, did we come up with a title for the show?
Oh, Disneyland or whatever.
Disneyland?
Arpiture.
Arpiture Labs.
I like Ant versus Man.
All right, Ant versus Ant, Man.
We put a versus in it.
Yeah.
It should be Ant v Man.
Ant v Man. Okay, I'll start uploading this stuff right away.
Oh, no, wait, hold on. Tom Higgins, die AntShwood.
Die AntShwood.
That's pretty good. Okay, well, hey, I'll tell you what, guys. I think I'm going to take us off the air. Andrew, real quick, there is something else I wanted to kick over to you, but I'm going to play a little bit of music, and we'll see you guys later on. It's good times.
I gotta go hitchhike.
It was delightful. I felt like things got really weird there for